very happy that this game today is being brought to all of you, not only over the CBS Radio Network, but it's going all around the world via Armed Forces Radio to our fighting men and women overseas, up into Alaska, over to Hawaii, and of course at the outposts all around the world. And so to all of you who are so far away from home during this holiday season, and who I know to a man and to a woman are wishing you were here, for as much as it can be, we want to wish you a very, very happy and healthy New Year. The last of the ground crew work is being accomplished now. They're going around on the field and picking up little tacked down pieces of snow, sort of slicing them off the surface of the grass, getting them off to one side or another of the field. The field markings are still visible. We question how long that situation will be in effect, and it will probably be a situation where your guess will be as good as mine on exactly where the ball is when it gets down there in the center portion of the field and where it's been churned up a good bit. Looking at the comparative strengths of these two teams, let's discuss that for a moment. I think, beginning on defenses, that the Green Bay Packers have to be conceded a stronger defensive team than the Cleveland Browns. Their record certainly speaks of it. And they are going to give Jim Brown a very stern test. And Jim Brown has been tested sternly by the Western Division throughout this season. I think against Minnesota, he picked up something like 39 yards, and against Los Angeles, he was held to about 20 yards. But would you agree that the edge goes to Green Bay on defense?
Yes, Jack, I would. I think you have to give Green Bay the edge. And, of course, they're going to have to stop Jimmy Brown. And looking at the season of the Cleveland Browns, you can see that they were 11-3. And the two games that you just mentioned, Jack, you were correct. Against Minnesota, the Vikings held him to 39 yards. And against the Los Angeles Rams, he was held to 20 yards. So those two teams stopping Jimmy Brown were able to contain the Cleveland Browns. If you run down the Green Bay Packers defense, Willie Davis and Ron Kostelnik, Henry Jordan and Lionel Aldridge, that front four, they're not only big, but they're very mobile. And I think in Willie Davis, the Green Bay Packers have perhaps one of the finest defensive ends to come along in a long, long time. Their linebacking corps is excellent also, led by their fine middle linebacker, Ray Nitschke, and the two outside linebackers, Dave Robinson and Leroy Caffey, have great range, good speed, and they're real good hitters. And then you move into the secondary of Herb Adderley, Doug Hart, Tom Brown, and Willie Wood, and you find that those four, combined with the linebackers, led the National Football League in interceptions with a total of 27. So I definitely think the edge has to be given to Green Bay defensively because of the fine men and the fine record they've been able to compile this year. And defensively, Vince Lombardi likes to go with just the standard 4-3. No tricks. You'll find Green Bay, if they hold to their general play pattern, will blitz very, very little today because this has been their pattern for the past couple of years. They don't like to get fancy. Vince Lombardi is a strong believer in doing the things all the time that you do well, and the Packers play that standard pro defense very well.
On offense, I'd say the edge goes a bit to Cleveland, mainly because of the presence of Jimmy Brown, who is, without question, the greatest runner in the National Football League or in anybody's football league today. At quarterback, I'd shape him up as about even. Frank Ryan for Cleveland and Bart Starr for the Green Bay Packers, in my opinion, are both highly confident, more than adequate quarterbacks, and their backup men are about the same. Zeke Bartkowski and Jim Nanowski for Cleveland. They are veterans. Frank Ryan and Jim Nanowski have each played through this NFL contest 8 years. And Bart Starr and Zeke Bartkowski are both 10-year veterans. So that the man behind the starter is a veteran in his own right. And, of course, with the Cleveland or with the Green Bay Packers, Zeke Bartkowski has come in and won 4 games this year. Taking a look at the fullback position between the two teams, each team has a great fullback, Jim Brown, and the Green Bay Packers, Jimmy Taylor. Jimmy Taylor is more of an inside runner. Jimmy Brown can go outside very effectively. And for Jim Taylor, a good deal of how Taylor goes depends on how healthy Horning is. Horning is a superb blocker, and Taylor has a much better day with Horning in the backfield than when Horning is sidelined, as Paul has been with recurring injuries through the season. Jim Brown really doesn't appear to depend much on anybody, except that is a fallacious statement on its face, because you've got to have men blocking for you to get you started at least. But Brown has a tremendous ability to run through tackles and run over and around. A great deal of Brown's running yardage this year, and he gained a total of 1,544 yards, I believe it was, has been the fact that the Cleveland Browns have been able to get into the lead. One of the tricks of defeating Cleveland is to get the lead on them and force Frank Ryan to go to the air and not utilize Jimmy Brown. I'll guarantee you there is no team in football more difficult to beat than the Cleveland Browns if they are leading in the fourth quarter. They just run Jimmy Brown at you play after play, pick up first downs, maintain ball control, and it's almost impossible to get your hands on the football. At the halfback position, Ernie Green has developed very much this year for Cleveland, has really come into his own as a fine ball carrier, but I still have to put him a little bit behind Paul Horning when Horning is healthy. In just a moment, the game will be underway with the opening kickoff.
Professional coaches really know their football. They know when their fullback is taking too many steps before the handoff. They know when their linemen are hitting an inch too low making their blocks. They have to know, or they'd soon be out of a job. Another professional who has to know is your mobile dealer. It's his job to know your car and to know how to keep it in top shape and running properly.
Morning, sir. Shall I fill her up? Premium?
Yes, please. After he fills your tank with Mobil Premium High Energy Gasoline, the trained Mobil dealer can check your cooling system for possible leaks, keep your battery at full operating power, test your tires for safety, and protect your car with high-grade Mobil lubricant. Remember, for good advice and good products, you can depend on your Mobil dealer.
To all of you on this CBS radio network and Armed Forces Radio around the world, we're moments away from the beginning of this championship football game for the National Football League Championship between the Cleveland Browns and the Green Bay Packers. Down on the field, the starting lineups are being introduced. Let's take a look at the starters here. Offense for the Green Bay Packers, who won the toss and are scheduled to receive, Boyd Dollar will be starting at left end. He's 6 feet five, 225 pounds, a seven-year veteran, and one of the great split ends in the league. The principal pass receiver for the Green Bay Packers, Bob Skoranski, at 250 pounds, will be starting at left tackle, and he is an eight-year veteran. Fuzzy Thurston was one of those injured in the playoff game against Baltimore last week, but I was mentioning earlier how the adrenaline flows in these two games, and they play in spite of injuries. And Fuzzy Thurston refused to be substituted. Send your substitute back to the sideline, saving the game in that game against Baltimore. He's 245 pounds, an eight-year veteran. Ken Bowman is a youngster, so to speak, in this offensive line, a two-year man from the University of Wisconsin playing at center. He's 6'3 and 230 pounds. The right guard is Jerry Kramer. Kramer and Thurston have long been famed as one of the very best pairs of offensive guards in the NFL. Jerry Kramer, the other one, is 245, likewise an eight-year veteran. Then we get to Forrest Gregg, who's been a handyman for the Packers this year. He is starting right tackle, 250 pounds, but he can also play guard and does back up Fuzzy Thurston when Thurston, from time to time, is in sideline with injury. Miles Fleming has done more than an adequate job of coming in as the tight end, with Ron Kramer being traded to Detroit. He's 6'4", weighs 235 pounds. The quarterback will be Bart Starr. Bart Starr will start at quarterback. He's been a question mark all week with some damaged ribs, but he's able to throw, and he's going to open up at that position. The running back spot, nominally called the left halfback, is the man that holds the record for the most points scored in an NFL championship game. That's Paul Horning. And he scored 19 points for that record. He's an eight-year veteran, 215 pounds. Jimmy Taylor will be starting at fullback. Likewise, 8 years in the NFL from Louisiana State and 215 pounds. The flanker back will be Carol Dale.
He's 6'2", 200 pounds, has good speed and very good move. For the Cleveland Browns, when they take the football, Paul Warfield is scheduled to start at the split-in position. The speedster is back and available to the Cleveland Browns. Nick Shafrath has been introduced as the starting left tackle. He was running with a trace of a limp, may not be around for the entire game. 255 pounds, a seven-year veteran from Ohio State. At left guard will be Johnny Wooten, likewise a seven-year veteran from Colorado, 250 pounds. John Morrow is one of the fine offensive centers in the NFL, been in the league 9 years, weighs 248. And Dean Hickerson will be starting at right guard from Ohio State, a six-year veteran, another 248-pounder. At 265 pounds from Southern Cal, the right tackle, a seven-year veteran, will be Monty Clark. And Johnny Brewer, who has been a very fine tight end for the Cleveland Browns this year and one of their principal pass receivers, will be starting at that position. Frank Ryan will be at quarterback. Ernie Green will be starting at the left halfback position. This is his fourth year in NFL play, and this is the year that Ernie Green really came into his own as the talented football player that he is. Jim Brown needs very little further conversation from me. He'll be starting at fullback, and he is a great one, 228 pounds. Jerry Collins will be the sixth or flanker back. Maryland, four-year veteran. He holds a record, along with Otto Graham, for the most touchdowns scored in the championship game three. But Otto Graham, surprisingly, got his by rushing. Gary Collins holds the record all alone for catching the most touchdown passes in the championship game, that same number of three. So there is the situation. The Cleveland Browns are coming out on the field with a veteran, Lou Groza, who himself is setting the National Football League record today by the number of appearances as a member of the championship team. This is his ninth time that he has been involved in an NFL championship game, and he will kick off to the Green Bay Packers. The deep men for the Green Bay Packers going back, number 26 is Herb Adderley, and number 25 is Tom Moore. And we're now just seconds away from the start of the NFL championship game. This is Jack Greaves along with Jim Morse, and here we go. Groza puts a good throw in the football, and it is taken by Tom Moore right on the goal line. He's back to the 15, cuts to his right, gets to the 20, and is dropped along the 22-yard line. That was Sidney Williams, number 67, coming in to make the tackle, and it'll be the Green Bay Packers starting out, first and 10 on their own 23. As they break the huddle, coming up over the ball. One flanker out, and he's set wide to the right. Boy, Dollar split a little bit at left end. Bart Starr gives the ball to Paul Horning, and Horning hit the end of the line. Is caught as he punches through the 25. Looks like he fell forward to about the 26-yard line. Vince Costello and Bill Glass combining to make the tackle for the Cleveland Browns.
Bill Glass making the stop on Paul Horning.
Ball is up at the 26, Jim. Jack, I think that's the type of football we'll see by both teams here this afternoon, both Cleveland and Green Bay. The straight-ahead stuff and the power stuff are the type of football that works on slippery fields like we have here in Green Bay. Second down, a little better than 6 yards to go by Sowers. Back to pass, gets beautiful protection, and throws to Horning. Horning looks away as it dropped incomplete. They hit him in the chest, but Horning was beginning to lift for a direction to go. He took his eyes off that ball just a shade too soon, dropped it, and it is now third down and about 6 yards to go with the ball on Green Bay's 26-yard line. Green Bay wearing green jerseys today, gold pants and helmets, white new. Cleveland Browns are all in white with orange helmets, and their jerseys are trimmed in orange and brown. Third down now, 6 yards to go. Merrill out wide to the left. Boyd Dollar out wide to the right. Passing situation, of course, and that's what Bart Starr is going to do, and he throws to Jimmy Taylor and hits Taylor. And it's the first down as Taylor makes the catch up at the 35, and he drops on the 36-yard line. Was made by Galen Fisk. Cleveland Browns. Jim?
Now that's right, Jack. Green Bay had four quick receivers because both Paul Horning and Jimmy Taylor did come out of the backfield as receivers. They had a minimum of blocking, but Dark Star still had plenty of time to get the ball away.
First and 10 on the 36-yard line. End of the flank are both out. Houston are up in a virtually a 6-1 defense. It's Jimmy Taylor taking the handoff, and no hole there. He stopped around the series, and then he backed off about a half a step and had another shot at it and picked up about 4 yards, getting that ball up to the 39-yard line.
3 yards, let's call it.
Jim Houston, the left linebacker. Jim Kinnicky, the right tackle, coming in to make the stop for Cleveland. Second ball on 7 minutes to go. Bill Anderson has come in at the tight end position for the Green Bay Packers. Well, there goes out very wide to the left side. There's a flanker out there. Tight end is set to the left. The throw is to Harding again. That same play, and this time Paul Harding held the ball as he took it up to the 47-yard line. Vince Costello and Jim Houston combined to bring him down. The ball is at the 47. Pick up of 8 yards on that play, and it's enough for another first down.
Jack, on a slippery field like this, it's generally conceded that the offense has somewhat of an advantage because, particularly on a pass touch, as Harding just had, he knows where he's going, the defender doesn't, and he took a step inside, and he was wide open.
Well, there, wide to the left. Jimmy Taylor has a hole inside left tackle, and takes it through there, picks up, looping up the piezo to move that ball down to the 47-yard line. Well, Vince Costello made the tackle, and now they have moved the ball into Cleveland Brown territory. So it's second down and about 5 yards to go.
8 and 5 on the play. Second and 5.
And now the Green Bay Packers have moved the ball over on the Cleveland side of the 50-yard line. They're up against now a 6-man line. 2 linebackers peel off at the snap. They were right up on the line as soon as there's a bomb. As Bart Starr throws for a goal, and he makes the catch down at the 15. He's at the 10, he's at the 5, and he's in there and throws him up. Well, there, the Packers are back. Made that grab on the 15. Touchdown strike. Walter Beach was attempting cover on that play. And couldn't keep up with Caldell. Now with Star to hold, Don Chandler has come in to try for the extra point. The kick is good. So it's Green Bay 7, Cleveland nothing. Play is stopped on the field. Here's Jimmy Moore. Jack, I was talking about that just a moment ago prior to that pass play. On a slippery field like this, the offensive receiver definitely does have the advantage, and we saw it here when Paul Harding caught a pass, and on that touchdown pass to Carroll Dale. Actually, it was kind of a fluttery pass, and Dale had to come back for it. However, he did make the catch and eluded two tacklers after that. He's a great football player, and it's early in the football game yet, however, and anything can happen, and generally does here in the National Football League.
Leroy Kelly and Roberts are in the deep position to receive Chandler's kick.
And now we're ready for the kickoff. Don Chandler will be kicking off. Leroy Kelly and Walter Roberts are the deep men for the Cleveland Browns. The Jet Setters are called two very talented speedsters. They can really move with that football. Chandler's kick is quite short. And it's taken by Charlie Scales on the 15-yard line. One of the men forming the screen in front of the deep man. And Scales is able to bring that ball back to the 30 and is dropped up around the 33 or 34. Junior Coffey made the tackle, number 21 for the Cleveland, for the Green Bay Packers. And the ball is spotted. Let's see, I've got to count them now. 10, there's the 20, there's the 30, the 34-yard line. The yard lines are just about obliterated here, and certainly the numbers that indicate which is which are covered with snowdrifts from the cleaning off of the field. We sort of have to count from one end to the other every now and then to orient ourselves in this football game. So it's the first time Cleveland has had the football. Frank Ryan is quarterback. And Ryan's going to throw on first down. Looks downfield, throws one over to the sidelines for Jimmy Brown, and Brown makes the catch, a spectacular catch, down on the 35-yard line of the Green Bay Packers, and he is out of bounds at that point. Peeling off the cover over there was Ray Nitschke, as the Cleveland Browns got a one-on-one situation with Brown and Nitschke. Jim?
First down.
And Jack, that's the identical play that Green Bay pulled a few moments ago when they had the ball. That time, both Jimmy Brown and Ernie Green were out of that backfield as receivers. Apparently, both coaches feel that they can afford, on a day like this, to send their backs out because perhaps with the slippery conditions, the defensive line is not able to rush quite as fast.
Well, they picked up 30 yards on that pass play to Jim Brown. Ryan is back to throw once again, and this time he looks over there and hits Paul Warfield. Warfield just planting in from his widespread left-end position. Diagonally toward the center of the field, gathered the ball at the 20, and was dropped on the 16-yard line by Willie Wood. Call at the 17-yard line. Doug Hart, trying to keep up with Warfield on the play, but Warfield got the step on him and was clear to receive the pass. The Green Bay Packers are leading in the ballgame 7-0 with a little better than 10 minutes to play in the first quarter. But certainly the Cleveland Browns are knocking at the door. They're on the 17-yard line now, 1st and 10. Ryan back to throw once again. Boy Dollar, or rather Gary Collins, has it in the end zone, and the Cleveland Browns are right back in the ballgame with a touchdown. Herb Adderley was over there trying to keep up with Gary Collins. But Collins really left him behind as he was about 5 yards to the clear in the end zone and gathered in the floating pass from Frank Ryan. And suddenly this ball game is practically even Steven once again. Lou Groza hasn't missed an extra point all year. He's come in to try it. Pass, and Groza picks up the ball. He's going to try and throw a forward pass. Takes it out to the 35, but he couldn't get over for the extra point. The pass from center was fumbled, and the score holds at 7-6. And the Green Bay Packers have a one-point lead as they prepare to receive the Cleveland kickoff. So each team has scored. The first time they've had their hands on the ball. And it's 7-6 now with 10 minutes and 7 seconds left to play in the first quarter of the game. Waiting at the 40-yard line to get the football teed up. And the deep men are number 26, Herb Adderley, and number 25, Tom Moore, for the Green Bay Packers. Now the ball is handed to Lou Groza. Sitting on the field, being somewhat slippery, is giving both these quarterbacks somewhat of an edge. The blitzers and the rushing linemen can't get the footing to really come storming in there. Lou Groza has now a perfect passing record with 1-for-1 in the NFL. Groza's kick is short, and it bounces back over the head of Herb Adderley, who's coming up to try and field it on the bounce, and it goes back into the end zone. Well, he goes back to Dallas for the touchback, and it'll be 1st and 10 on the 20-yard line for Green Bay. So the score is Cleveland 6, Green Bay 7, as Green Bay takes it 1st and 10 on the 20.
Jack, earlier in our broadcast, I went on record as giving the Green Bay Packers the edge on defense, but I think we must all remember that we had a similar situation last year in Cleveland, with Baltimore being given the edge, and Cleveland, of course, went on to win the World Championship 27-0.
Corey and Taylor, the running backs. Carroll Dale out wide to the right. Boyd Dollar playing tight at left end. And the ball is given to Horning, and Horning is nailed and thrown for a loss. He came up there by Paul Wigan on left end before the Cleveland Browns, who had no one blocking him, moved right into the Green Bay Packer backfield, enveloped Horning, and put him down on the, the 18-yard line. So it's a loss of close to 2 yards. It'll be 2nd down and 12.
Ball resting on the Packers.
Ball back on about the 18-yard line. 2nd down, around 12 yards to go for Green Bay. Ball QTR goes back to throw. And takes one for the sidelines for Boyd Dollar. Those a little high, and he could only get one hand on the ball. Went beyond him and out of bounds to be incomplete. Covering was Bernie Parrish. And that'll make it third down. There's 12 yards to go for the Green Bay Packers.
Jack, you can see out there that ball is definitely hard to handle because although Bart Starr has not completed either two or three passes, he hasn't thrown a spiral yet. He's thrown a couple of knucklers and one end over end, and that one, the last one actually, was end over end.
Carabell goes out wide to the left. Boyd Dollar out wide to the right. 12. Starr looks downfield, can't find anybody. He is knocked to the ground, and the play is dead. He wasn't tackled. He was knocked down by Jim Kanicki, number 69, and Bill Glass was also storming in there for the Cleveland Browns. But since he hit the ground as a result of contact with the defense, the ball is down back on the 8-yard line. And so the Green Bay Packers cannot record the first down. They run out of downs. It's fourth down now, and about 22 yards to go. And Don Chandler is back to kick. Kelly and Roberts underneath it, and as the punt goes off, Kelly signals for a fair catch. Takes that ball, and it is down on the 39-yard line. Now, we have an interesting situation here. They're only 39 yards away, and they could put the ball in play with a free kick following a fair catch, and if they booted it between the uprights, it would be a field goal. However, they are not going to do that. They're coming out into a regulation scrimmage play. Paul Warfield is set as a flanker to the left. The pitch out is to Jimmy Brown, and Brown swings around the side, but with good pursuit. Number 77 came out of the pack. Ron Kostelnik caught him from behind and rode him to the ground as he got that ball up to about the 36-yard line. Dave Robinson coming up to help out. Ron Kostelnik shot around from his tackle position, was trailing the play, and as Jimmy Brown did a couple of half steps for a moment, waiting for the hole to open, he got to him from behind. So a second down. Ball is on the 37-yard line. And it's second down and about 7 yards to go. About 8 yards to go. Ryan back to throw, hits Paul Warfield. Warfield catches him on the 30, can't quite get loose. He is downed as he gets to the 24 with Dunbar coming over there to make the tackle. Ray Nitschke was moving in trying to put pressure on Ryan, but as we mentioned before, both quarterbacks are having time to throw today because the footing is not conducive for a quick, solid start. And the charging defensemen can't, they sort of spin their wheels a little bit before they can get going and get in there. So the ball now is down on the 25-yard line, and it's first and 10. Paul Warfield on wide to the left. Ball is given to Jim Brown. Brown looking for a place to go, finds one off tackle to the right as he danced around behind the line of scrimmage for a moment, and finally took that ball down inside the 20-yard line where Dave Robinson caught him and drove him back, helped out by Willie Davis. Jim?
Jack, the last two times that Jim Brown has carried the ball, you get an idea of why he's so effective. He can take the ball up the middle or around the end. Several years ago, they used to use him primarily just up the middle. But in the last 3 years, particularly since Bratton Collier has been there as the head coach, they've used him both ways and made him even more effective than he was in previous years.
Second down and 5 yards to go. The ball just inside the 20-yard line. Ryan back to throw once again. Has to run out of the pocket now and looks like he's going to run, but he slips and skids on the slippery footing as he tried to cut. Ground and then was kept down there by Ray Nitschke coming up very fast and Dave Robinson simply dropping on him. But he avoided a loss on the play as he took that ball down to the 17-yard line to pick up three.
Gain of two on the play.
It's third down now and a shade better than 2 yards to go. The score in the ball game is Green Bay 7, Cleveland 6. Cleveland scored a touchdown, but on a fumble on the passing center, missed the extra point. Ryan and Ernie Green are both back in the running back spot. Warfield wide to the left. Ryan looks for Warfield. Close one into the end zone, and Warfield can't quite get to it. Paul Warfield was clear as he ran what they call a post pattern. That means the eventual cut is toward the goalpost. And he was right between them when the pass got there, but he couldn't quite get to it. Doug Hart, covering on the play, had been dropped a couple of steps behind Warfield. Pass was a shade too far, Jim.
And although Paul Warfield has been out all year with an injury, he certainly doesn't look to me as if he's lost any of his finesse, his speed, his timing, or his ability to cut. He's been open three times and caught two already in this football game.
And now they're going to try for a field goal from 24 yards away. It's fourth down. Groza's kick is on the way, and Groza's kick is good, and the Cleveland Browns take the lead. So the score is Cleveland 9, Green Bay 7. Timeout is called on the field to play. The score, Cleveland 9, Green Bay 7.
Your Ford quieter than my Jaguar? Not jolly likely.
That's Rob Walker, one of England's foremost automotive sportsmen. I'm Ford's quiet man. My assignment? Demonstrate the extraordinary quiet of the 66 Ford to owners of some of the world's finest cars. First, we drove Rob Walker's great Mark N Jaguar, and a very quiet machine it was. Then it was the 66 LTD's turn. We drove around the vast estate, and I could tell that Rob was impressed by the quiet quality of the LTD.
I believe your Ford really is quieter.
Not by much, I said. Rob was stiff upper lip about the results. In the best British tradition, and in the best American tradition, why not prove Ford's quiet to yourself? Quiet test the 66 Ford at your Ford dealership.
And now we're about ready for Lou Groza to kick off. The deep men are Herb Adderley and Tom Moore for the Green Bay Packers. Bart Starr is in on 3 out of 5 forward passes. Frank Ryan is in on 4 out of 5. The kickoff drop into the arms of Tom Moore at the 5. He's back across the 15 and 20, and is finally dropped as he gets that ball up through the area of the 23, 24-yard line. Coming in there to make the stop was number 38, Sam Zurich. Johnny Brewer, number 83. So the Green Bay Packers now trailing 9-7. Take the ball first and 10 on their own 23-yard line. 77 yards away from payoff territory, and it's a pitch out. It comes back to Taylor. Taylor gets his first block, but the secondary defenders are up very quickly. And also moving fast was Dick Mozeleski, the tackle, who slid over and moved in, and he made the stop at about the 22-yard line. We pause 10 seconds for station identification. This is with CBS, the radio network.
CBS in Gloversville, Youngstown, WENT, 1340 on your radio dial.
The 21-yard line, off the 2, second down and 12. End and flank are both out for the Green Bay Packers as Bart Starr drops straight back, has time, throws downfield, throws too high, pass interference call, holding the target, couldn't get to the football. Vince Costello, on whom it was called, is logical protest down there, but to no avail as the yellow flag is down. Pass interference, not quite the call. They're calling them for holding against the Cleveland Browns. They were holding up, not pass interference, and that is a 5-yard penalty from the previous spot, but it still gives them an automatic first down. And the ball is now at the 27-yard line. Ball at the 27, first and 10. Boy Dollar is in tight to the right side. Gerald Dale is split wide to the left. The ball is given to Paul Horning. Horning coming around the bend, breaks loose at the line of scrimmage, gets loose up to the 40 to the 50, and is finally caught from behind to wrestle down as he takes that ball all the way down through the Cleveland Browns 39-yard line. Jim Houston coming in to finally make the tackle. A 34-yard run, Jim.
Any fears that the Green Bay Packers fans had that Paul Horning was not 100% prior to this football game. I'm sure now it's been dispelled because he shook off a couple of tacklers then at the line of scrimmage and almost broke it.
First and 10 on the Cleveland 39. Starr back to throw. A quick sideline pass. Pitch out there to Carroll Dale, who takes it, spins back to the inside, and runs from the 35 where he caught the ball down to around the 33-yard line. Walter Beach was over covering on the play. Vince Costello came up quickly to make the tackle when he spun away from Walter Beach. Ball is at the 28-yard line. First down. Cleveland leads 9-7 over the Green Bay Packers. 3 minutes, 12 seconds left to play in the first quarter of the game. Inman and Frank are both out. Carroll Dale is wide to the right this time with Dowler split out to the left. The ball is given to Jimmy Taylor. He has a hole off tackle, gets through it and on down to around the 20-yard line where Dick Modzelewski come up to make the stop for the Cleveland Browns. So the ball is at the 21, a pickup of 7 yards on the play. It'll be second down and about 3. Jim?
Jack, you mentioned prior to the football game that Jimmy Taylor always seems to play better when Paul Horning is in the backfield. We got a good idea why on that last play, because Horning threw the block actually on the defensive end that sprung Taylor.
Second and 4. Ball on the 22.
Ball down at about the 21-yard line. Ball start calling signals, gives the ball over to Jimmy Taylor, and Taylor, bouncing over the left side, is able to go to the first down as he takes it down now to around the 16-yard line. Bill Glass, number 80, coming in to make the tackle for Cleveland. First and 10 on the ball, let's call it the 17-yard line. Nice blocking by Bob Skoransky in the tackle position and by Paul Horning. On the 17-yard line, first and 10 for Green Bay. Carroll Dale coming out wide to the right. Boyd Dowler split to the left, running back in position to run. And the handoff is to Hornan. Hornan gets a nice block from Jimmy Taylor, slices inside of him, takes it down to around the 10-yard line. Let's see where they dig out the football. Looks like it's going to be put around the 13. Yes. Ball placed on the 13-yard line, a pickup of 4. Tackle made by Jim Houston, the left side linebacker, and Vince Costello, the middle linebacker. Joe Bostar now is calling on his talented pair of running backs, Horning and Taylor, and they are moving the ball on the ground. Second down now, and shade better than 6 yards to go. The ball on the 13-yard line. Carroll Dale comes out wide to the right once again. Six-man front looking at the Packers. Taylor bangs right into the middle of it, carries him with him, and takes it down inside the 10. That ball will be spotted on about the 8-yard line. Nick Modzelewski, number 74, 260 pounds, and Paul Wigan, the left end, 245 pounds, were both moved backwards by Jimmy Taylor's tremendous drive.
Jack, week after week, it continues to amaze me the precision with which these professional football teams operate. I was down on the field before the game. It's extremely slippery out there. That ball is hard to handle, but yet we have not seen a fumble in the football game.
Third down and about 3 yards to go now. The ball on the 9-yard line. Horning takes the handoff, gets blocking, looking for a room around the corner, cuts inside the corner there to Walter Beach as he came up and was blocked out. And he's down close to the first down. He's in the area of the 6 or 7 yard line. Ozzie Thurston out there doing a fine job of leading the play on blocking. And that is the end of the first period. The score is 1-9, Green Bay 7. Paul Horning when Horning is healthy. In just a moment, the game will be underway with the opening kickoff.
Professional coaches really know their football. They know when their fullback is taking too many steps before the handoff. They know when their linemen are hitting an inch too low making their blocks. They have to know, or they'd soon be out of a job. Another professional who has to know is your mobile dealer. It's his job to know your car and to know how to keep it in top shape and running properly.
Morning, sir. Shall I fill it up? Premium?
Yes, please. After he fills your tank with Mobile Premium High Energy Gasoline, the trained Mobile dealer can check your cooling system for possible leaks, keep your battery at full operating power, test your tires for safety, and protect your car with high-grade Mobile lubricant. Remember, for good advice and good products, you can depend on your Mobile dealer.
To all of you on this CBS radio network and armed forces radio around the world, we're moments away from the beginning of this championship football game for the National Football League Championship between the Cleveland Browns and the Green Bay Packers. Down on the field, the starting lineups are being introduced. Let's take a look at the starters here. Offense for the Green Bay Packers, who won the toss and are scheduled to receive, Boyd Dollar will be starting at left end. He's 6 feet 5, 225 pounds, a 7-year veteran, and one of the great split ends in the league. The principal pass receiver for the Green Bay Packers, Bob Zielinski, at 250 pounds, will be starting at left tackle, and he is an 8-year veteran. Fuzzy Thurston was one of those injured in the playoff game against Baltimore last week, but I was mentioning earlier how the adrenaline flows in these key games and they play in spite of injuries. And Fuzzy Thurston refused to be substituted. Send your substitute back to the sideline, stayed in the game in that game against Baltimore. He's 245 pounds, an 8-year veteran. Ken Bowman is a youngster, so to speak, in this offensive line, a 2-year man from the University of Wisconsin playing at center. He's 6'3 and 230 pounds. The right guard is Jerry Kramer. Kramer and Thurston have long been famed as one of the very best pairs of offensive guards in the NFL. Jerry Kramer, the other one, at 245, likewise an 8-year veteran. Then we get to Forrest Gregg, who's been a handyman for the Packers this year. He is starting right tackle, 250 pounds, but he can also play guard and does back up Fuzzy Thurston when Thurston, from time to time, is in sideline with injury. Miles Fleming has done more than an adequate job of coming in as the tight end, with Ron Kramer being traded to Detroit. He's 6'4", weighs 235 pounds. The quarterback will be Bart Starr. Bart Starr. Very happy that this game today and being brought to all of you, and not only over the CBS radio network, but it's going all around the world via Armed Forces Radio to our fighting men and women overseas, up into Alaska, over to Hawaii, and of course at the outposts all around the world. And so to all of you who are so far away from home during this holiday season, and who I know to a man and to a woman are wishing you were here. For as much as it can be, we want to wish you a very, very happy and healthy New Year. The last of the ground crew work is being accomplished now. They're going around on the field and picking up little packed down pieces of snow, sort of slicing them off the surface of the grass, getting them off to one side or another of the field. The field markings are still visible. We question how long that situation will be in effect, and it will probably be a situation where your guess will be as good as mine on exactly where the ball is when it gets down there in the center portion of the field and where it's been churned up a good bit. Looking at the comparative strengths of these two teams, let's discuss that for a moment. I think, beginning on defenses, that the Green Bay Packers have to be conceded a stronger defensive team than the Cleveland Browns. Their record certainly speaks of it. And they are going to give Jim Brown a very stern test. And Jim Brown has been tested sternly by the Western Division throughout this season. I think against Minnesota, he picked up something like 39 yards, and against Los Angeles, he was held to about 20 yards. But would you agree that the edge goes to Green Bay on defense?
Yes, Jack, I would. I think you have to give Green Bay the edge. And, of course, they're going to have to stop Jimmy Brown. And looking at the season of the Cleveland Browns, you can see that they were 11-3. And the two games that you just mentioned, Jack, you were correct. Against Minnesota, the Vikings held him to 39 yards. And against the Los Angeles Rams, he was held to 20 yards. So those two teams stopping Jimmy Brown were able to contain the Cleveland Browns. If you run down the Green Bay Packers defense, Willie Davis and Ron Kostelnik, Henry Jordan and Lionel Aldridge, that front four, They're not only big, but they're very mobile. And I think in Willie Davis, the Green Bay Packers have perhaps one of the finest defensive ends to come along in a long, long time. Their linebacking corps is excellent also, led by their fine middle linebacker, Ray Nitschke, and the two outside linebackers, Dave Robinson and Leroy Caffey, have great range, good speed, and they're real good hitters. And then you move into the secondary of Herb Adderley, Doug Hart, Tom Brown, and Willie Woods, and you find that those four, combined with the linebackers, led the National Football League in interceptions with a total of 27. So I definitely think the
Star will start a quarterback. He's been a question mark all week with some damaged ribs, but he's able to throw, and he's going to open up at that position. The running back spot, nominally called the left halfback, is the man that holds the record for the most points scored in an NFL championship game. That's Paul Hornung. And he scored 19 points for that record. He's an eight-year veteran, 215 pounds. Jimmy Taylor will be starting at fullback. Likewise, 8 years in the NFL from Louisiana State and 215 pounds. The flanker back will be Carl Dale. He's 6'2", 200 pounds, has good speed and very good move. For the Cleveland Browns, when they take the football, Paul Warfield is scheduled to start at the split-end position. The speedster is back and available to the Cleveland Browns. Nick Shafrath has been introduced as the starting left tackle. He was running with a trace of a limp, may not be around for the entire game. 255 pounds, a seven-year veteran from Ohio State. At left guard will be Johnny Rubin, likewise a seven-year veteran from Colorado, 250 pounds. John Morrow is one of the fine offensive centers in the NFL. Been in the league 9 years, weighs 248. Gene Hickerson will be starting at right guard from Ohio State, a six-year veteran, another 248-pounder. At 265 pounds from Southern Cal, the right tackle, a seven-year veteran, will be Monty Clark. And Johnny Brewer, who has been a very fine tight end for the Cleveland Browns this year and one of their principal pass receivers, will be starting at that position. Frank Ryan will be at quarterback. Bernie Green will be starting at the left halfback position. This is his fourth year in NFL play, and this is the year that Ernie Green really came into his own as the talented football player that he is. Jim Brown needs very little further conversation from me. He'll be starting at fullback, and he is a great one, 228 pounds. Jerry Collins will be the sixth or flanker back, Maryland, four-year veteran. He holds a record, along with Otto Graham, for the most touchdowns scored in the championship game three. But Otto Graham surprisingly got his by rushing. Jerry Collins holds the record all alone for catching the most touchdown passes in the championship game, that same number of three. So there is the situation. The Cleveland Browns are coming out on the field with the veteran Lou Groza, who himself is setting the National Football League record today by the number of appearances as a member of the championship team. This is his ninth time that he has been involved in an NFL championship game, and he will kick off to the Green Bay Packers. The deep men for the Green Bay Packers going back, number 26 is Herb Adderley, and number 25 is Tom Moore. And we're now just seconds away from the start of the NFL championship game. This is Jack Greaves along with Jim Morse, and here we go. Groza puts a good throw in the football, and it is taken by Tom Moore right on the goal line. He's back to the 15, cuts to his right, gets to the 20, and is dropped along the 22-yard line. That was Sidney Williams, number 67, coming in to make the tackle, and it'll be the Green Bay Packers starting out, first and 10 on their own 23. As they break from the huddle, coming up over the ball. One flanker out, and he's set wide to the right. Boy, Dollar split a little bit at left end. Bart Starr gives the ball to Paul Hornung, and Hornung hit into the line. Is caught as he punches through the 25. Looks like he fell forward to about the 26-yard line. Vince Costello and Bill Glass combining to make the tackle for the Cleveland Browns.
Bill and Glass making the stop on Paul Hornung.
Ball is up at the 26, Jim. Jack, I think that's the type of football we'll see by both teams here this afternoon, both Cleveland and Green Bay. The straight-ahead stuff and the power stuff are the types of football that works on slippery fields like we have here in Green Bay. Second down, a little better than 6 yards to go by Sowers. Back to pass, gets beautiful protection, and goes to Horning. Horning looks away as it dropped incomplete.
Mark
hit him in the chest. But Horning was beginning to look for a direction to go. He took his eyes off that ball just a shade too soon, dropped it, and it is now third down and about 6 yards to go with the ball on Green Bay's 26-yard line. Green Bay wearing green jerseys today, gold pants and helmets, white and blue. The Cleveland Browns are all in white with orange helmets, and their jerseys are trimmed in orange and brown. Third down now, 6 yards to go. Merrildale out wide to the left. Boyd Dollar out wide to the right. Passing situation, of course, and that's what Bart Starr is going to do, and he throws to Jimmy Taylor and hits Taylor. And it's the first down as Taylor makes the catch up at the 35, and he drops on the 36-yard line. Was made by Galen Fisk. Down. Jim?
Now that play, Jack. Green Bay had four quick receivers because both Paul Horning and Jimmy Taylor did come out of the backfield as receivers. They had a minimum of blocking, but he still had plenty of time to get the ball away.
First and 10 on the 36-yard line. End of flank of both out. Cleveland up in virtually a 6-1 defense. Did Jimmy Taylor taking the handoff and no hole there. He stopped the line of shooting. Then he backed off about a half a step and had another shot at it and picked up about 4 yards, getting that ball up to the 39-yard line. 3 yards, let's call it. Jim Houston, the left linebacker. Jim Kinnicky, the right tackle, coming in to make the stop for Cleveland. Second ball on 7 yards to go. Bill Anderson has come in at the tight end position for the Green Bay Packers. Merrildale goes out very wide to the left side. There's a flanker out there, tight end to set to the left.
The edge has to be given to Green Bay defensively because of the fine men and the fine record they've been able to compile this year. And defensively, Vince Lombardi likes to go with just the standard 4-3. No tricks. You'll find Green Bay, if they hold to their general play pattern, will blitz very, very little today because this has been their pattern for the past couple of years. They don't like to get fancy. Vince Lombardi is a strong believer in doing the things all the time that you do well, and the Packers play that standard pro defense very well.
On offense, I'd say the edge goes a bit to Cleveland, mainly because of the presence of Jimmy Brown, who is without question the greatest runner in the National Football League or in anybody's football league today. At quarterback, I'd shape him up as about even. Frank Ryan for Cleveland and Bart Starr for the Green Bay Packers, in my opinion, are both highly confident, more than adequate quarterbacks, and their backup men are about the same. Zeke Bartkowski and Jim Nanowski for Cleveland. They are veterans. Frank Ryan and Jim Nanowski have each played through this NFL contest 8 years. And Bart Starr and Zeke Bartkowski are both 10-year veterans. So that the man behind the starter is a veteran in his own right. And, of course, with the Cleveland or with the Green Bay Packers, Zeke Bartkowski has come in and won 4 games this year. Taking a look at the fullback position between the two teams, each team has a great fullback, Jim Brown, and the Green Bay Packers, Jimmy Taylor. Jimmy Taylor is more of an inside runner. Jimmy Brown can go outside very effectively. And for Jim Taylor, a good deal of how Taylor goes depends on how healthy Horning is. Horning is a superb blocker, and Taylor has a much better day with Horning in the backfield than when Horning is sidelined, as Paul has been with recurring injuries through the season. Jim Brown really doesn't appear to depend much on anybody, except that is a fallacious statement on its face, because you've got to have men blocking for you to get you started at least. But Brown has a tremendous ability to run through tackles and run over and around. A great deal of Brown's running yardage this year, and he gained a total of 1,544 yards, I believe it was, has been the fact that the Cleveland Browns have been able to get into the lead. One of the tricks of defeating Cleveland is to get the lead on them and force Frank Ryan to go to the air and not utilize Jimmy Brown. I'll guarantee you there is no team in football more difficult to beat than the Cleveland Browns if they are leading in the fourth quarter. They just run Jimmy Brown at you play after play, pick up first downs, maintain ball control, and it's almost impossible to get your hands on the football. At the halfback position, Ernie Green has developed very much this year for Cleveland, has really come into his own as a fine ball carrier, but I still have to put him a little bit behind. And Walter Roberts, the deep man for the Cleveland Browns, the jet setters, are called two very talented speedsters. They can really move with that football. And the kick is quite short. And it's taken by Charlie Scales on the 15-yard line. One of the men forming the screen in front of the defense. And Scales is able to bring that ball back to 30 and is dropped up around the 33 or 34.
Charlie Scales returns
Chandler's
kick.
Junior Coffey made the tackle, number 41 for the Cleveland, for the Green Bay Packers. And the ball is spotted. Let's see, I've got to count them now. 10, there's the 20, there's the 30, the 34-yard line. The yard lines are just about obliterated here, and certainly the numbers that indicate which is which are covered with snowdrifts from the cleaning off of the field. We sort of have to count from one end to the other every now and then to orient ourselves in this football game. So it's the first time Cleveland has had the football. Frank Ryan is quarterback. And Ryan's going to throw on first down. Looks downfield, first one over to the sidelines for Jimmy Brown, and Brown makes the catch, a spectacular catch, down on the 35-yard line of the Green Bay Packers, and he is out of bounds at that point. Peeling off the cover over there was Ray Nitschke, as the Cleveland Browns got a one-on-one situation with Brown and Nitschke. Jim?
First down.
And Jack, that's the identical play that Green Bay pulled a few moments ago when they had the ball. That time both Jimmy Brown and Ernie Green were out of that backfield as receivers. Apparently both coaches feel that they can afford on a day like this to send their backs out because perhaps with the slippery conditions the defensive line is not able to rush quite as fast.
Well, they picked up 30 yards on that pass play to Jim Brown. Ryan is back to throw once again, and this time he looks over there and hits Paul Warfield. Warfield just planting in from his widespread left-end position. Diagonally toward the center of the field, gathered the ball at the 20, and was dropped on the 16-yard line by Willie Wood. Well, at the 17-yard line, Doug Hart, trying to keep up with Warfield on the play, but Warfield got the step on him and was clear to receive the pass. The Green Bay Packers are leading in the ballgame 7-0 with a little better than 10 minutes to play in the first quarter. But certainly the Cleveland Browns are knocking at the door. They're on the 17-yard line now, 1st and 10. Ryan back to throw once again. Boyd Dollar, or rather Gary Collins, has it in the end zone, and the Cleveland Browns are right back in the ballgame with a touchdown. Herb Adderley was over there trying to keep up with Gary Collins. But Collins really left him behind as he was about 5 yards to the clear in the end zone and gathered in the floating pass from Frank Ryan. And suddenly this ball game is practically even Steven once again. Lou Groza hasn't missed an extra point all year. He's come in to try it. And Groza picks up the ball. He's going to try and throw a forward pass. Takes it out to the 35. But he couldn't get over for the extra point. The Boston center was fumbled. And the score holds at 7-6. And the Green Bay Packers have a 1-point lead as they prepare to receive the field kickoff. So each team has scored. The first time they've had their hands on the ball. And it's 7-6 now with 10 minutes and 7 seconds left to play in the first quarter of the game. Waiting at the 40-yard line to get the football teed up. And the deep men are number 26, Herb Adderley, and number 25, Tom Moore, for the Green Bay Packers. Now the ball is handed to Lou Groza. Sitting on the field, being somewhat slippery, is giving both these quarterbacks somewhat of an edge. The blitzers and the rushing linemen can't get the footing to really come storming in there. Will Groza has now a perfect crossing with some damaged ribs, but he's able to throw, and he's going to open up at that position. The running back spot, nominally called the left halfback, is the man that holds the record for the most points scored in an NFL championship game. That's Paul Hornung. And he scored 19 points for that record. He's an eight-year veteran, 215 pounds. Jimmy Taylor will be starting at fullback. Likewise, 8 years in the NFL from Louisiana State and 215 pounds. The flanker back will be Carol Dale. He's 6'2", 200 pounds, has good speed and very good move. For the Cleveland Browns, when they take the football, Paul Warfield is scheduled to start at the split-end position. The speedster is back and available to the Cleveland Browns. Dick Shaffrath has been introduced as the starting left tackle. He was running with a trace of a limp, may not be around for the entire game. 255 pounds, a seven-year veteran from Ohio State. At left guard will be Johnny Wooten, likewise a seven-year veteran from Colorado, 250 pounds. John Morrow is one of the fine offensive centers in the NFL, been in the league 9 years, weighs 248. Gene Hickerson will be starting at right guard from Ohio State, a six-year veteran, another 248-pounder. At 265 pounds from Southern Cal, the right tackle, a seven-year veteran, will be Monty Clark. And Johnny Brewer, who has been a very fine tight end for the Cleveland Browns this year and one of their principal pass receivers, will be starting at that position. Frank Ryan will be at quarterback. Ernie Green will be starting at the left halfback position. This is his fourth year in NFL play, and this is the year that Ernie Green really came into his own as the talented football player that he is. Jim Brown needs very little further conversation from me. He'll be starting at fullback, and he is a great one, 228 pounds. Jerry Collins will be the sixth or flanker back. Maryland, four-year veteran. He holds a record, along with Otto Graham, for the most touchdowns scored in a championship game three. But Otto Graham, surprisingly, got his by rushing. Jerry Collins holds the record all alone for catching the most touchdown passes in a championship game, that same number of three. So there is the situation. The Cleveland Browns are coming out on the field with the veteran Lou Groza, who himself is setting the National Football League record today by the number of appearances as a member of the championship team. This is his ninth time that he has been involved in an NFL championship game, and he will kick off to the Green Bay Packers. The deep men for the Green Bay Packers going back, number 26 is Herb Adderley, and number 25 is Tom Moore. And we're now just seconds away from the start of the NFL championship game. This is Jack Drees along with Jim Morse, and here we go. Groza puts a good throw in the football, and it is taken by Tom Moore right on the goal line. He's back to the 15, cuts to his right, gets to the 20, and is dropped along the 22-yard line. That was Sidney Williams, number 67, coming in to make the tackle, and it'll be the Green Bay Packers starting out, first and 10 on their own 23. As they break from the huddle, coming up over the ball. 24. One flanker out, and he's set wide to the right. Boy, Dollar split a little bit at left end. Bart Starr gives the ball to Paul Hornung, and Hornung hitting into the line. Is caught as he punches through the 25. Looks like he fell forward to about the 26-yard line. Vince Costello and Bill Glass combining to make the tackle for the Cleveland Browns.
Bill and Glass making the stop on Paul Hornung.
Ball is up at the 26, Jim.
Jack, I think that's the type of football we'll see by both teams here this afternoon, both Cleveland and Green Bay. The straight-ahead stuff and the power stuff are the types of football that works on slippery fields like we have here in Green Bay.
Second down, a little better than 6 yards to go by Sowers. Back to pass, gets beautiful protection, and throws to Hornung. Hornung looks away as it dropped incomplete. He hit him in the chest, but Hornung was beginning to lift for a direction to go. He took his eyes off that ball just a shade too soon, dropped it, and it is now third down at about 6 yards to go with the ball on Green Bay's 26-yard line. Green Bay wearing green jerseys today, gold pants and helmets, white new. The Cleveland Browns are all in white with orange helmets, and their jerseys are trimmed in orange. We're very happy that this game today is being brought to all of you, not only over the CBS Radio Network, but it's going all around the world. via Armed Forces Radio to our fighting men and women overseas, up into Alaska, over to Hawaii, and of course at the outposts all around the world. And so to all of you who are so far away from home during this holiday season, to who I know to a man and to a woman are wishing you were here, for as much as it can be, we want to wish you a very, very happy and healthy New Year. The last of the ground crew work is being accomplished now. They're going around on the field and picking up little tacked down pieces of snow, sort of slicing them off the surface of the grass, getting them off to one side or another of the field. The field markings are still visible. We question how long that situation will be in effect, and it will probably be a situation where your guess will be as good as mine on exactly where the ball is when it gets down there in the center portion of the field and where it's been churned up a good bit. Looking at the comparative strengths of these two teams, let's discuss that for a moment. I think, beginning on defenses, that the Green Bay Packers have to be conceded a stronger defensive team than the Cleveland Browns. Their record certainly speaks of it. And we are going to give Jim Brown a very stern test. And Jim Brown has been tested sternly by the Western Division throughout this season. I think against Minnesota, he picked up something like 39 yards, and against Los Angeles, he was held to about 20 yards. But would you agree that the edge goes to Green Bay on defense?
Yes, Jack, I would. I think you have to give Green Bay the edge. And, of course, they're going to have to stop Jimmy Brown. And looking at the season of the Cleveland Browns, you can see that they were 11-3. And the two games that you just mentioned, Jack, you were correct. Against Minnesota, the Vikings held him to 39 yards, and against the Los Angeles Rams, he was held to 20 yards. So those two teams stopping Jimmy Brown were able to contain the Cleveland Browns. If you run down the Green Bay Packers defense, Willie Davis and Ron Kostelnik, Henry Jordan and Lionel Aldridge, that front four, you can, they're not only big, but they're very mobile. And I think in Willie Davis, the Green Bay Packers have perhaps one of the finest defensive ends to come along in a long, long time. Their linebacking corps is excellent also, led by their fine middle linebacker, Ray Nitschke, and the two outside linebackers, Dave Robinson and Leroy Cappy, have great range, good speed, and they're real good hitters. And then you move into the secondary of Herb Adderley, Doug Hart, Tom Brown, and Willie Wood, and you find that those four, combined with the linebackers, led the National Football League in interceptions with a total of 27. So I definitely think the edge has to be given to Green Bay defensively because of the fine men and the fine record they've been able to compile this year. And defensively, Vince Lombardi likes to go with just the standard 4-3. No tricks. You'll find Green Bay, if they hold to their general play pattern, will blitz very, very little today because this has been their pattern for the past couple of years. They don't like to get fancy. Vince Lombardi is a strong believer in doing the things all the time that you do well. And the Packers play that standard pro defense very well.
On offense, I'd say the edge goes a bit to Cleveland, mainly because of the presence of Jimmy Brown, who is, without question, the greatest runner in the National Football League or in anybody's football league today. At quarterback, I'd shape him up as about even. Frank Ryan for Cleveland and Bart Starr for the Green Bay Packers, in my opinion, are both highly confident, more than adequate quarterbacks, and their backup men are about the same. Zeke Bartkowski and Jim Nanowski for Cleveland. They are veterans. Frank Ryan and Jim Nanowski have each played through this NFL contest 8 years. And Bart Starr and Zeke Bartkowski are both 10-year veterans. So that the man behind the starter is a veteran in his own right, and of course with the Cleveland or with the Green Bay Packers, Zeke Bartkowski has come in and won 4 games this year. Taking a look at the fullback position between the two teams, each team has a great fullback, Jim Brown, and the Green Bay Packers, Jimmy Taylor. Jimmy Taylor is more of an inside runner. Jimmy Brown can go outside very effectively. And for Jim Taylor, a good deal of how Taylor goes depends on how healthy Horning is. Horning is a superb blocker, and Taylor has a much better day with Horning in the backfield than when Horning is sidelined, as Paul has been with recurring injuries through the season. Jim Brown really doesn't appear to depend much on anybody, except that is a fallacious statement on its face, because you've got to have men blocking for you to get you started at least. But Brown has a tremendous ability to run through tackles and run over and around. A great deal of Brown's running yardage this year, and he gained a total of 1,544 yards, I believe it was, has been the fact that the Cleveland Browns have been able to get into the lead. One of the tricks of defeating Cleveland is to get the lead on them and force Frank Ryan to go to the air and not utilize Jimmy Brown. I'll guarantee you there is no team in football more difficult to beat than the Cleveland Browns if they are leading in the fourth quarter. They just run Jimmy Brown at you play after play, pick up first downs, maintain ball control, and it's almost impossible to get your hands on the football. At the halfback position, Ernie Green has developed very much this year for Cleveland, has really come into his own as a fine ball carrier, but I still have to put him a little bit behind Paul Hornung when Hornung is healthy. In just a moment, the game will be underway with the opening kickoff.
Professional coaches really know their football. They know when their fullback is taking too many steps before the handoff. They know when their linemen are hitting an inch too low, making their blocks. They have to know, or they'd soon be out of a job. Another professional who has to know is your mobile dealer. It's his job to know your car and to know how to keep it in top shape and running properly.
Morning, sir. Shall I fill it up? Premium?
Yes, please. After he fills your tank with Mobil Premium High Energy Gasoline, the trained Mobil dealer can check your cooling system for possible leaks, keep your battery at full operating power, test your tires for safety, and protect your car with high-grade Mobil lubricant. Remember, for good advice and good products, you can depend on your Mobil dealer.
To all of you on this CBS radio network and armed forces radio around the world, we're moments away from the beginning of this championship football game for the National Football League Championship between the Cleveland Browns and the Green Bay Packers. Down on the field, the starting lineups are being introduced. Let's take a look at the starters here. Offense for the Green Bay Packers, who won the toss and are scheduled to receive, Boyd Dollar will be starting at left end. He's 6'5", 225 pounds, a 7-year veteran, and one of the great split ends in the league. The principal pass receiver for the Green Bay Packers, Bob Zielinski, at 250 pounds, will be starting at left tackle, and he is an 8-year veteran. Will be Fuzzy Thurston. Fuzzy Thurston was one of those injured in the playoff game against Baltimore last week, but I was mentioning earlier how the adrenaline flows in these key games and they play in spite of injuries. And Fuzzy Thurston refused to be substituted. Send his substitute back to the sideline, stayed in the game in that game against Baltimore. He's 245 pounds, an 8-year veteran. Ken Bowman is a youngster, so to speak, in this offensive line, a 2-year man from the University of Wisconsin playing at center. He's 6'3 and 230 pounds. The right guard is Jerry Kramer. Kramer and Thurston have long been famed as one of the very best pairs of offensive guards in the NFL. Jerry Kramer, the other one, is 245, likewise an 8-year veteran. Then we get to Forrest Gregg, who's been a handyman for the Packers this year. He is starting right tackle, 250 pounds, but he can also play guard and does back up Fuzzy Thurston when Thurston, from time to time, is in sideline with injury. Miles Fleming has done more than an adequate job of coming in as the tight end, with Ron Kramer being traded to Detroit. He's 6'4", weighs 235 pounds. The quarterback will be Bart Starr. Bart Starr will start at quarterback. He's been a question mark all week and bound. Third down now, 6 yards to go. Merrill out wide to the left. Boyd Dollar out wide to the right. Passing situation, of course, and that's what Bart Starr is going to do. And he throws for Jimmy Taylor and hits Taylor. And it's a first down as Taylor makes the catch up at the 35 and is dropped on the 36-yard line. Drop was made by Galen Fisk. Down. Jim?
Now that play, Jack, Green Bay had four quick receivers because both Paul Hornung and Jimmy Taylor did come out of the backfield as receivers. They had a minimum of blocking, but he still had plenty of time to get the ball away.
First and 10 on the 36-yard line. End of flank of both out. We've been up in a virtually a 6-1 defense. Jimmy Taylor taking the handoff and no hole there. He stopped the series. Then he backed off about a half a step and had another shot at it and picked up about 4 yards, getting that ball up to the 39-yard line. 3 yards, let's call it. Jim Houston, the left linebacker. Jim Kinnicky, the right tackle, coming in to make the stop for Cleveland. Second ball on 7 yards to go. Bill Anderson has come in at the tight end position for the Green Bay Packers. Well, there goes out very wide to the left side. There's a flanker out there. Tight end is set to the left. The throw is to Harding again. That same play, and this time Paul Harding held the ball as he took it up to the 47-yard line. Vince Costello and Jim Houston combined to bring him down. The ball is up to 47. Pick up of 8 yards on that play, and it's enough for another first down.
Jack, on a slippery field like this, it's generally conceded that the offense has somewhat of an advantage because, particularly on a pass cut, as Harding just had, he knows where he's going, the defender doesn't, and he took a step inside and he was wide open.
Well, there, wide to the left. Jimmy Taylor has a hole inside left tackle, and takes it through there, picks up, move that ball down to the 47-yard line. Well, Vince Costello made the tackle, and now they have moved the ball into Cleveland Brown territory. So it's second down and about 5 yards to go.
Gain of 5 on the play. Second and 5.
Second and 5, and now the Green Bay Packers have moved the ball over on the Cleveland side of the 50-yard line. They're up against now a 6-man line. 2 linebackers peel off at the snap. They were right up on the line as soon as there's a bomb. As Bart Starr goes for a goal, and he makes the catch out of the 15. He's at the 10, he's at the 5, and he's in there standing up. Bart Starr with a big back. Made that grab on the 50. Well, then operating three Cleveland defenders to go into the end zone, standing up, and the Green Bay Packers have taken a 6-0 lead. A 47-yard touchdown strike. Walter Beach was attempting to cover on that play. And couldn't keep up with Caldell. Now with Starr to hold, Don Chandler has come in to try for the extra point. The kick is good. Green Bay 7, Cleveland nothing. Play is stopped on the field. Here's Jimmy Moore. And Jack, I was talking about that just a moment ago prior to that pass play. On a slippery field like this, the offensive receiver definitely does have the advantage, and we saw it here when Paul Harding caught a pass, and on that touchdown pass to Carroll Dale. Actually, it was kind of a fluttery pass, and Dale had to come back for it. However, he did make the catch and eluded 2 tacklers after that. He's a great football player, and it's early in the football game yet, however, and anything can happen, and generally does here in the National Football League.
Leroy Kelly and Robert are in the D position to receive Chandler's kick.
Now we're ready for the kickoff. Don Chandler will be kicking off. Leroy Kelly.